great to be here. Good afternoon, I'm Jonathan. I work at Leigh Jonathan Steingiesser. And it's great to see such a great turnout to our section. We know it's going to be a little bit different because we're expecting a textual or some code. I'm going to disappoint you, not going to have any of that. But we will have some great stories from a world design career that might help you and inspire you and talk to you, whether you're a designer, developer, analyst, whatever you do in this wonderful industry of art. And we're going to be covering starting out, failing, growing, reading, and sharing as well, which is why I'm here today. So let's get into it. I want to thank all of our sponsors. Without them, we wouldn't be here today. So thank you. Let's give a big warm welcome from DDDPerth for our special guest, Nick, who's flown in all the way from Big Five to be here. From startups to agency life and WA's biggest institutions, Nick has built and led design teams and a broad spectrum of industries. And Nick's here to share with us some insights from that journey. So Nick, where did it all begin?
Hey, folks, how are you doing? Okay, I already owe Jonathan a beer because we predicted the audience at 6. So, so just a 30 second background. Obviously, with my broad Aussie twang, I was born in Stoke on Trent, north of England. I kind of jumped out of university and being me, disappeared to Canada and completely missed all of the graduate recruitment. So, I came back with very little to do. But I hung out with a mate, and he had a friend who needed a bit of help. And he said, can you just go and sort this guy out for a couple of weeks, just do some stuff, you can find him if you can make it up. And I graduated in business. I go and visit this bloke, and one of them shed in a back garden. So this is proper 90s startup stuff. This is like literally, I am not kidding you, a 4 meter square garden shed. Which in it had two of the most amazing things I've ever seen in my life. A Mac Quadra and a Mac Century 750. Absolutely amazing stuff. So all of a sudden, I was into the world of graphic design. That was a little business that went on for a while, and lots of amazing things happened. So I guess I'll talk through that journey first. We had an amazing time. We fell upon a gap in the market, a hole in the industry now. So for the first 5 years of my career, I was doing Reaper graphics. Has anybody ever heard of Reaper graphics? Yeah? One? Cool. this is the bit before digital. This is where I learned all about print and basic visual design and print setting, etc. It was the best of times. I started on Photoshop 2.0 before layers. That was interesting. We had a great time building a business. And one of the first things I guess we learned was immediately to say yes to any and every goddamn job that came our way, whether or not we had the kit or the skills or the time to do it or not. So that's my first reflection, first learning from you guys. If it feels right and you're in the field and you can get a sense of what's going on around you and you think, damn it, I'm just going to say we're going to do that, do it, see what happens, and then work it out afterwards. We're totally agile 25 years ago, honestly. It was crazy. So we started branching out into really silly things like high resolution scanning. You know, this is the world before digital photography. Japan's freaked a load of people out in Stranger Things 3. Have you seen that? Stranger Things 3? And they got the bedroom with the thing. We would have to transfer amazing images into high quality images, going into image correction and all sorts of things. No idea how to do it. And from that, we started tapping into the pottery industry, and they started bringing things and saying, do colour separation. What is colour separation? I have no idea, but I ended up doing it for 3 years. That was just amazing stuff. So, say yes, learn how to do it afterwards. The second thing that really helped me do that was, the more and more we took that on, and my boss, the guy who actually owned the chair, I started to do more work, so I became the contact point, and after racing around like an idiot, doing the work, delivering the work, meeting the clients, all of a sudden it came to the fore that I was the man. And the first time, and that's not such a slang, but I'm a man, it just happened. When I walked in one day to one of our biggest clients, he just said to me, he sat down, and I said, I'm a young guy, this is a big serious bloke in a big company, and sat down and said, Nick, you're the man. and to work with him. And that was a real moment when I thought, well, stuff I found myself doing that I wasn't trained for, I don't know how to do, I'm doing. And that gave me a sense of confidence.
And did you have any points when you were starting to reflect on how can I be doing this better? How can I perhaps, you know, not just reacting, going out there? Did that occur to you at that point? Or was that
not at all. So I would say, you know, when you're in your early to mid-20s, you've got all that energy, all this crazy stuff going on around you, take advantage of those first few years. You have the capacity to do silly stuff like work through the night, which I cannot tell. How many people have done all-nighters? And I don't mean studying for university, I mean like scared, ignorant, that you've got to deliver things, and it's all going on. And, yeah. One of the most amazing times we had, and I was regaining the story the other day, because I'll never forget it. So we took on a commission, this was the Say Yes thing, before we realised what the hell we were doing, to do an exhibition. Now this was at the National Exhibition Centre in the UK. One of the halls is about the size of this entire convention centre. So that was three halls big full of motorbikes. And one of our clients was a motorcycle distributor, so they said, ah, there's an exhibition stand. Cool, we'll design it and build it and all sorts of stuff. Anyway, £100,000 worth of business later, when we're going, oh God, we had to build this thing, and we had 48 hours to get the thing finalised and printed and done. We'd done our usual, said yes, then bought a giant printer, like one of these large format things, 5 metres wide. It broke. Got all my files, everything's ready, I'm totally convinced, Spark Express was the thing, it looked good. Yeah, 2 laps by a block, hello. We did that talk at the time, I don't give a shit. But it all went horribly wrong, and we committed. And there's no way we were not going to deliver this thing. Next minute, we're down at Hertz Rentals, getting a bloody van and driving the thing up, loading our files on, you know, the zip drives at that time. There's no cloud drive thing, you just load it onto the zip drive. And another one in case the first one doesn't work, and another one in case the first two fail. So it was chaos. Jumped into this van, 11 o'clock at night, off we go, down the bloody M6, M40, winding in Reading, in a place we've never been to, at Xerox headquarters, trying to print all the stuff. Can you imagine, 3 o'clock in the morning at this point, you've got £100,000 worth of business, so $200,000, printed out, you're checking it, you're mounting it, you're sticking magnets on the back, you're lining it all up, you hope you haven't missed the page, you want to control checking it, it's just exciting. But it's hilarious, and it was just one of the best experiences. So all in the van, hoping we got all the panels, drove back to Birmingham, set up this thing, 4 o'clock in the morning. At the same time as I'm setting it up, and this was a crack here, a digital loop, it was a video of Richard Blackthroat's right? And with Director, did anybody ever use Mac Media Director? On a really crappy old computer? Yeah, trying to get that video playing just at the same time as putting it in it. Long story short, 7 o'clock in the morning, we finally finished, all looking bleary eyed and weird, and then 8 a.m. the door's open, and it's just, yeah, you need to go through that experience. Understand what you're capable of, that you said you'll do it, that you'll be the one, and that you pull an all-night and you've committed to yourself, and you've achieved, you know, at least something that happened.
That's a great start, so if you recap for us, what are we, for our investors there?
If my high-quality Kensington point of which we get. Okay, so what are we going to do? We said, say yes, then learn how. That's probably not sensible in our enterprise world today, but I think sometimes it's the thing to do. Doesn't work. Oh, lag. There we go. Oh, this is going so well. Be the one who can. Be the man, woman, person that can. Figure out how to do it later today. That's how you build your early reputation, as weird as that sounds, but it is. You work on an all-nighter, we can discuss that later, right? And you'll learn lots along the way. Commit to doing it. The point about not committing is scary. If we had not done these ridiculous things, it would not have led to more business. And that's sort of the last point. By doing that client that I did that work for got me through my next 2 years. Because I left the business at this point, traveled to Australia, decided it was far sunnier than Stoke-on-Trent that I wanted to live in. So when I got back, I didn't have a job, and those clients knew I would commit, and I had them as freelance clients for the next 2 years. So, you know, follow those early successes.
And now, did you have any
Did I ever fail? failure, you know, everybody's moving into that knowledge now. Failure is your path to learning. There's such things as failure, just an outcome of learning. Yeah, I guess there's a few points worth talking about here. So, is that business brew? There's also a lot of hurdles. Any small business goes from 2 people to 8 people, 9 people, and things start to get out of hand. So, the first point is people. Early on, you get to understand who people are, especially working very closely with them in a small chain. But that gut instinct, when you're first meeting either clients or when you're meeting the legal core stakeholders, when you're first meeting people you want to employ or people you want to work with, the little tingle in the back of your head that says, "Whoa, there's something going on here," is always right. I guarantee you, something will come back to that. It may be a short loop, it may be a really, really long loop, but here's a hint, you're in Perth, it's going to come back. Right? It does not go far, one degree of separation. So have that bit of instinct. The second bit is you're going to rack up debt, and I don't just mean financial ones. You will rack up energy debt, you'll just rack up everything that becomes an overhead. And just when you thought things were going really, really well, things bite. And they always do. If you're in a corporate environment, I've had it so many times, when just that moment, again, this is that good instinct thing, just when it's all going smoothly. Back at that first company of mine, we had one major client. At one point, we had this one major client. And they were a big international name, and overnight they shut down. It was one of the weirdest things. You know, we had all this work out. At this point, I was doing in-store displays, I was doing packaging, I was doing interactive CD-ROM catalogs. Anybody ever done one of those? it was fantastic work, we were loving it, it was all good. And then one morning, I got a phone call, come down and pick up some stuff, like rock stuff, because half our equipment was down with them. Went down and the factory gates were closed on a huge business. Hundreds of people out of work without warning. So suffice to say, if you're in a startup, if you're in your own business, if you're a small business, if you're a contractor, don't bank on one person. I mean, it sounds logical, but it actually really happens, and I've been through that. Another thing that I guess I got wrong along the way, and I still get wrong today, is like, who's proud of their work? Anybody in this room proud of their work? No, you all are. Come on. Don't be too attached to it, especially designers. Designers, how many times have we had this conversation over way too many beers? We're precious lot. We like to do creative stuff, and when people tell us that our creative stuff isn't what we want, we run off and panic and get all sad and cry and doubt ourselves. And actually, learned something on Thursday that my reaction is pride. I do recommend that my reaction is brilliant, because if you get some feedback, if you're doing a project, if you drop it some code and it goes wrong, fight for a bit. It's really, really good.
At what point did you
put
the idea where you're working on a project and you went,
I'll be honest, I think that's only something that's taken a long time to learn. That as a designer, you are not the deliverer, you are part of a team, you are part of a thing, and even a delivery team is actually just a facilitator. You are facilitating a client's vision of what they want, and I guarantee you that is not what's in your head. So when you get that feedback loop that tells you that's not quite what I wanted, or can you just make that logo bigger.com, it's not orange enough, it's not very good. don't take it mentally, because the toll of reacting too hard to that, over time, especially 25 years when you're an old bugger like me, it will break you down and it will destroy your confidence. I guess over time I learned to separate just a little bit and understand quite philosophically, I guess, I'm just a curator of the work that's happening. So, but that's taken a lot of time to learn. So if you take one thing away, take that one away. You're all amazing, you're not that bad. Right? Stuff goes wrong, somebody else's opinion, what's going on. Yeah? And I guess the last point to mention on the point of failure is it's not about just delivering the work and doing the work. It's about who you are in your role, where you are at the time of your career. I've got a beautiful track record of coming second. Like, when I've gone for the big gigs and I've gone for a couple, I've had the, you're amazing, but you get the butt. And that one hurts a lot. It still hurts. that's not going to change over time. But again, if I look back, you know, every time that actually happened to me, I wound up in a better place because of it.
What do you go through? How do you go through that? Where do you go through?
Well, clearly, first you hide. you run off to go, oh God, I'm an absolute failure and nobody loves me, and da 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 da. And then get some coffee. Not beer, because that's not a good place to go. I think, again, it's taken time. The last time that happened to me was a big one, and that was probably the biggest that's hit me pretty hard. And that took about 6 months to get over that one. And if I'm honest, the thing that I did was put on a really, really brave face. I just put on a false, look, that's my thing to deal with. The people around me that I work with, and the people in my team, it's not their fault that I'm feeling this way. So you have to match it and put it to bed. It's super hard to do. I think we thought about it before in the chat last night. Sometimes that's where the care factor comes in, so I'll bring that one into the next one. Okay. So it doesn't go wrong all of the time, except when you're using a Kensington pointer. What did we learn there? Let's just round that one out. Such mental feelings about people. That's gained over time, you learn it. Oh, can't they come back to die? There will be deaths, so plan for them. Have an out. Have a thing on the side, not necessarily an actual business, but just a passion or a connection or a network. Come on. About that one main client, I think we all know that one. When the floor falls through, you're going to go. And so you're going to have to, again, have that other thing ready. Being precious is super stressful and definitely not sustainable over time to look after yourself. It's going to happen. You're not going to get the gig, okay? That will happen whether it's a project, whether it's a stakeholder you thought you could sell a project to, whether it was a job role. It's not going to happen. So learn some coping mechanisms. Oh, that jumped too, didn't it? Did that jump too?
Yeah.
I'm loving the quality of this. I wish to endorse this product.
So, you took a few steps back, and have you been taking steps forward? How do you go beyond that?
Okay, so let's jump a bit. We're no longer stuck on saying we're creating crazy businesses out of kids. So I'll probably talk about my 9 years at Curtin. I still bless and reflect very highly on my years at Curtin because it's fantastic. I immigrated to Australia. It's clearly Australia rocked. It's a super wonderful place full of fabulous people. I'm not saying that to suck up. I actually found the energy here really interesting. I find it's a confluence of folks who want to do and do better from everywhere. So it kind of fit like a rebuild after I had a business pretty much go down on me. 3 months, I couldn't be bothered to run it all myself. I came here, I found a job, I found a role, and I jumped into it. And a few things started to happen. So I guess there was a particular event which actually happened. Did it happen here? Yes, it did. When this was first opened, this convention centre, it was 2007. At the time, I was design manager or website manager or web manager of the Curtin University website, which was this amazing amalgamation, and my old director used to call it the Federal Republic of Yugoslavia, because it was literally hundreds of things stitched together to look like one. We all know what that is. So the problem is, at this point, there was no design consideration or customer consideration. It had no CX. It was built by the university, for the university, by IT people. We've never seen a customer or a student. So, I've got some beers, and then I'll laugh. No, but there's really, so look, this is still about customers more so than anything. There's a really, really fascinating moment where, and this was a great reveal, and I pray it happens to someone in this room, or maybe it'll happen at this conference today, where I somehow accidentally, the halfway jump, beautifully done, I somehow accidentally sat down next to the VC. So this is the person in charge, you know all of us, and the baby, you know all of us. And we're in this International Students Conference, which was the future of student recruitment across Australia, international students, blah, blah, blah. and a website experience company named Global Reviews, who are fantastic, by the way, had done an audit of Australian-based university websites. And I'm sitting there watching, and they said, and here's the top ranked 20 from a sample of 60. And the list started coming up. It was at MNU and Sydney University, and down and down. And my PC turns to me and says, where are we? I've been told we've got the best website. And I said, they told you that. And yeah, it was the director of IT. This is one of those magic moments when I said something unbelievably stupid, and I said, I can fix it. And the words came out, and I kind of meant it, but I didn't. That's a one, say yes, and then figure it out. So I just said, I can fix it. So that happened, and like a week later, I got a note through my director saying, hey, come talk. The VC wants to hear what your plans are. I'm like, what plan? So we walk into a room and had a chat, and then from nowhere, she said, so what's it going to take to get this website fixed? I said, well, give me $1 million and we can sort it out. And she did. Still mind blowing. It's like, what?
And in terms of design and design of community out there, the industry obviously wasn't where it is today. What did you do? You obviously had to learn.
This was the most amazing opportunity. So this was my personal growth. All of a sudden, I'm one of three people, because it's not myself, it's 200 people in the leadership team, and we built a unit which wound up being 24 people. But we went about it, and this is the first time that design and human-centered design really came to the fore. So what do? We got an information architect. We got a content writer. Oh my gosh, there's content that needs to be written for audiences? I thought we'd just make things and people read it. So off we went, and we planned a team, we put it together. I guess there's one thing to note there, design is fluid. This is the point where we began to realise. And just a bit of a personal story, and I definitely won't use names, but two of my designers in there, one chose to embrace it, and one was converting from graphic design to digital, and has gone on to have an absolutely sparkling career. Got obsessed with front-end code, really put the fear away and said, I can do digital, and he's done product development and everything, it's fantastic. The other one really struggled and didn't want to adapt, so I guess the lesson here is learning mindset. Take it on, do it, design, development, delivery. Who's a project manager anymore? We're all scrum masters. Everything changes constantly. It's a faster world, so be fluid. We've got to keep doing that. The expectations that come with it began to be huge, and that's the learning you get. You've got to deliver on that stuff. There's overload, there's disappointment when things start to really struggle, and there's some fragile circles. So if I can sum up, I guess, that 9 years, there's a bunch of lessons I'd like to share with you. I've already mentioned be fluid in your career. Design is fluid. Bruce Lee says, do you want to be the glass or be the water? Be the water. Expectations, closely follow issues when you step up, when you say, I've got give me $1 million and I'll deliver you a team, do it. Those expectations are really serious, and you have those horrible things called KPIs. Yeah, why do people have to keep it? Measures. Without metrics, you can't measure how progress is going to overload is ever present. Look, it's going to happen to you. I think that we've had this in our chats before. I never understood overload in my 20s when I was running like an idiot, sleeping on the couch. I watched the Twin Towers in 2001 whilst waking up on the couches watching it in my office. It was just that happened. But overload creeps up. At 26, I was on an ECG having my heart monitor because I thought I had a heart attack. So it takes some self care to have sustainability and persistence in your career as well. Until now, I've not realised I need to make time space for myself. And there was a piece that came up the other day about the opportunity that pauses between an event happening and your reaction to it. It's like a real pause, and the pause is the important thing. And I would definitely say that time. Previously, I would just go crashing through to things to solve them, react two arms flying at
once. That's two X, that's two Y.
Now, I'll do the high pick for a nanosecond. Then I will probably pick myself up and do a bobble up. Do a lap. Go outside, get some air, lots of things. So, manage the overload. The disappointments are inevitable. We've already talked about failing. And the circle around you is super fragile. People that, you know, if there's one thing, how many times have I said if there's one thing? One of the most important things is making those connections, those relationships with people you work with. It's super fragile because you won't be working with them for long. And I'll get on to that in the next piece, which is leading.
So would you say, are you more at those days, you know, managing a team, but also leading, you have that relationship with the topic? Would you say more of a manager or a leader or a bit of both?
I'll let other people tell me which I am. You don't understand what it's like to be a leader until you wind up being a leader. And there's a few key things there. You find yourself in that situation, I wouldn't say that you strive to be in charge of people. Who actually wants to be a manager? Oh, I'd like to be a manager. You don't want that in that situation. When you find yourself in a situation, how to coordinate a brilliant team of people, it's your responsibility to help you do that. And I had to learn so much that I hadn't even thought about, that it's not what I do, that's not who I am, to keep those people fed, supported, and driven. It's that nature. You've got to take a view of what's everybody going to deliver for me. That was a great sentence I learned early on. You are now accountable to make sure you deliver to others. That's another scary one. But in that, I guess, I've had to do a lot of recruitment in my time, and there's one really big piece here. I would say if you find yourself in the situation of being involved in selecting folks, hire for aptitude. People talk about hiring for innovation and creativity and blah, blah, blah. No. Hire for aptitude. That word is really, really strong. I encourage you to use it. I've hired totally unsuitable, inexperienced people in my time who've turned out to be the best colleagues, the best delivery people. They've got that innate, I can do this, deer in headlights, let's do it, and that. If you see that spark, have a go for it. It does get isolated and lonely when you're at the top, and that's a really scary thing to become accustomed to. You do find yourself on your own, so I'll talk about that in a minute. But there's one thing, and I have to go to the slides for this one. The door is always revolving, I think I've already said that. We were really blessed that everybody got backwards, so I'm sorry about this. I was blessed in having a static team for 4 years. For 4 years, it was 10 hours, and nobody left, because you were having such a bloody good time discovering what design really meant, and nobody left. So that was a moment in time, but it was fragile because it ended, and everything ended, and you got uncomfortable with that. So there we go, the door never stopped revolving. One little story I've got to share, if Kensington will stop letting me down. This is real. This is not me, but this actually happened. One day, early on, there was total bevel and chaos in the office. There was 5 others on 10 Macs outputting simultaneous large format prints, high-res scanning, the clients queued up at the door, the phones going crazy, that absolute whirlwind of pressure was really happening. And it got to the point where we all just burst out laughing. And I'll never, ever forget it. It was gold. We were so stressed out. I started doing T-Rex impressions up and down the corridor. And then Roddy McDowell, Planet of the Apes impressions, and people were flying past on chairs playing Superman. And it just broke the ice and it got the work done. And so it's really important that you back off and make space for fun, because it also brings the team together. Anyway, I'm not saying that I'm a dinosaur suit. I am. I want to see it. All right, we've got to get to where we need to get to.
So, what happens when you're leading, you're managing, and you then move on compared to the first you're going to pick, which you're not maybe so often. I bet you're going to go to the orange company. What's your next stage for your life?
I guess quite a lot of time. So, after Kirk, I went to GSV Low. I had an absolute bloody riot for 2 years being in an agency. So back on the agency side, which is, what the account manager says goes, not what human centered design told you the outcome. Anybody with an agency? I have a very rich culture of human-centered design. I guess, you know, I've been about this 5 years now, and something has struck me recently, and I think it is to do with the fact, one, I suddenly have this horrible realisation that I've been working for 25 years, and then over an early morning strong cup of coffee, I suddenly went, there's probably 25 things I've learned in 25 years, which is what I mean today. And I thought, I've never really stopped and never really thought about that, and never really planned forward by looking back. So I guess it comes to a point where you realise there's probably a responsibility and accountability, and I think the folks that I'm connected with now quite closely have discovered this as well. You, by just doing over time, you have a body of experience and a body of skills, whether they're good or bad skills, I don't know. Leave that to others to work out. But you can replay them. And how do you foster the next generation? How do you make those connections? And that's where it comes to, you think, I've got to start sharing this stuff. There's got to be an outlet. It just puts out of you. So that just happened.
And I think the day link we did in, I think, where everyone, I think, when they did that role, we did that, we had that imposter syndrome as a designer.
Oh, right. Exactly.
You don't need to be an expert. I think sharing and being a part of a community.
Critiquing is an interesting one. I'm still getting burnt by my filter. Sometimes I completely freewheel it and say things that I don't understand the outcomes and the consequences of saying. So I guess be mindful of you. It's a really, I fight with this one because it's Jonathan just said. The design is you constantly check yourself and you worry that you're not doing exactly what you're supposed to be doing, or you feel like an imposter. But also, I feel wildly between going, why should I moderate myself to be this other person when that's the true me, versus moderating myself to work better with people who are not like it. And I should probably do more of the latter, because emotional intelligence and having a broad spectrum of emotional intelligence is hard to do, but super critical if you're going to be well regarded and keep your job. It works with stakeholders. You have to motivate yourself and temper yourself. Even a couple of weeks ago, I had a really tough meeting and had to go to places that really tested me to not even stomp out of the room and hide or punch somebody. It's worth going to those extremes to test yourself, so that's really good. You'll find out not only with people that you're having to deliver through, but you'll find it with stakeholders as well. I mean, how many times do we bang heads with, you know, other people in other parts of the business or in other parts of the value chain? It's going to happen forever because we're all programmed differently. That's a whole other talk to do. But yeah, moderating and exploring yourself and building that up is really important. Another thing that I've found to stop the imposter syndrome is do what you're doing right here today. You guys are doing the exact right thing, which is networking and meeting people like you, that you can share more stories with, that you can find amazing funnies with, a beer or two actually helps afterwards because it loosens it all up and they come out. It's amazing. The thing that has really re-inspired me over these various lessons is once I found I couldn't go any further and I didn't want, I had the experience of being at executive level and it was a terrifying place. I'm not very comfortable and it reignited my passion, my craft. And I thought, you know, people talk about a T. Has everybody heard about a T? Your professional development, and then you're supposed to go broad and have a, yeah, I'm going straight back down on the T now, because the left and right bit, I'm exhausted. I don't need to know anymore about that stuff. I've found new energy and new passion getting back into our amazing business of design.
How have you done that?
Reading. A lot of reading. I have been better to myself in terms of planning. There's a lot of stuff flying around on LinkedIn and all the places at the moment about productivity, about bettering yourself, being a better person, blah, blah, blah. A lot of it's more like your own, really kind of desperately boring. But some of it has been really, really good. So I'm finding myself to be a little more structured. Who's totally random? Is anybody just making up to go along? No, you're all massively, we're at DDD, you're all massively, as one. There's one random person, thank you for admitting it. game designer in the room. What you kind of instructed to organize yourself. But I found that there's trade-offs to make. And instead of too much TV, I will now switch the TV off and I'll pick up a design book. And there's a whole plethora of new stuff happening. And it's not just design, it's learning to react about how businesses are changing. And I'm finding amazing blog posts. I still don't have time for podcasts. I don't know who has time, but I have two small children, so podcasts, forget it. On the blog, I'm doing my email very quickly. Yeah, so I found reigniting the passion by finding a lot of new material. We are in a connected age. Our biggest opportunity now is the fact that we can find materials. We don't have to order them from Amazon, which we did 20 years ago, and wait for them to turn up. We can just talk to people and meet people. And that is absolutely incredible. We can share so much knowledge and connect people and find stuff out at a pace that we never knew we had. So I guess this sort of sharing thing, if I could just revisit it, Kensington will let me. No, Kensington will not let me. Can you reach? Okay, so five more things. Check the honesty filter. It's going to come back and bite you on the arse if you don't bother yourself. Mental and emotional intelligence. Understand the impact of the words you say, especially when there's other people involved. Resistance is absolutely futile. There'll always be the difficult stakeholder. There'll always be the blocker. Lately, I've been called a blocker quite a few times. Oh God, we can't wait for people to learn. Well, do you want to make the right thing or make the thing right? No, just make it and spend some money and hope it works. Anyway, different discussion. Did it to you as well? Replaying energized. It was interesting. If I can just reference somebody in the audience, and I'm sure they're online, Simon, your little note on designing your own life and taking time to stop and reflect. Now, that's been a big wake up call for myself.
Great job.
Yeah, thank you, Simon, for that. It's true, we don't often look and strategically look, take a step back from telling what we're doing. But that gives you really fresh energy to keep going. Have a sounding board, and not Simon Cowell, because he'll criticize the shit out of you. We're really lucky at the moment, I've stepped out by default proxy again, accidentally wound up and looking after a middle group. That's connected me with a lot of really amazing people that are all peers, and we share more stories. That keeps you saying, you realize you're not the lone nutter that's out there and driving vandals through the middle of England at 2 o'clock in the morning. Other people have done it too, and that is a constant source of learning and a constant source of grounding as well. If you don't stay grounded and connected, I'm really fortunate as well to have something to all say is be kind to the people you work with. I've got a lot of folks that I've worked with over the years that I'm still really good personal friends with, which is amazing. I've probably pissed off twice as many, but there's a handful that I have dinner with, my kids play with their kids, we have a great time. That keeps me grounded as well. It's amazing, it brings back and reminds where you're from. That's a great thing. And I guess the final really important thing that I've learned over 25 years, I've already sort of touched on it, but that is, give other people the stage. When you are accountable for a team, when you're accountable for a product or a project or something that relies on you orchestrating other resources to get it done, we've all met the person who stands up and goes, hey, thanks, and takes all the credit and runs away and sits and thinks, well, I did all the work. What's that about? That's not fair. You know how that feels, so don't do it to other people. I get really excited right now about letting other people try. And I think, again, when it comes to the sharing phase, it's really exciting to see, particularly dads and young people, just go for it and do unbelievably amazing things and give them the limelight. That's just the best reward to say, I've been there and I've done it, and I kind of don't need to know that anymore. I'm seeing the cycle happen again in the next generation. That is amazing. You guys have the stage. Put them forward, give them a chance. That's what we can do. That's the thing we've been down in Rockland's country this morning. That was pretty wild.
That's a great job. I think you're doing it. So, thanks everyone for coming, for joining us. And on that note, if you do want to get involved, we have a wonderful design community. And,
is that what you were on time now?
Some of us who organize meetups have just created perthdesign.org, which is just a way for you to join a Slack channel. We've got front-end developers and everyone outside of design as well, so I encourage everyone to look at that. It's our next meetup is on the 13th of August on co-designing indigenous communities, which is going to be a really great talk. And a massive thanks for Nick again, signing into the big card. And Bankwest for allowing you to see your dream. Nick's going to be the Bankwest field. We don't have time for questions, but he'll be there all day if you want to chat further. Both Nick and I are available on LinkedIn and happy to hear and mentor and give advice back. And thanks again to all of our sponsors.
Let's give you some sound out for lunch. Yeah.